Hey guys, so welcome to Coding After 30. I hope you guys are excited because everybody loves Chuck Norris. And in today's video, I'm going to show you how to create Chuck Norris random quote generator. Now, if you're a beginner and you're just learning JavaScript, this is perfect tutorial for you. By the way, if you're new to this channel, my name is Paul, and this is where I talk about switching careers later in life. So if this is something that you're interested in, consider subscribing. Before I jump into this video, I just want to say the reason this is important today is because you get to learn how to pull data from an API, and this will truly make your websites dynamic. Even though we're creating a very simple project, once you get the concept of fetching data from API, this is going to open up many possibilities to creating cool projects, because the truth is nobody wants a static HTML or CSS site where the information is hard-coded. People want to get dynamic information that's dynamically generated from an API or a database. So if this is something you're excited about, then stick around and we're going to go over the code. Hey guys, welcome to Coding After 30. In this video, I'm going to do a quick tutorial. And what are we going to make today? We're going to talk about this random joke generator, or Chuck Norris quote generator. So when you click on it, it's going to load it. Chuck Norris is the only person in the world that can actually email roundhouse kicks. You show another one, and then it'll show another one. And where are we getting these amazing quotes from? Well, we're getting it from the Chuck Norris API. So in this JavaScript tutorial for complete beginners, we're actually going to cover a lot of interesting things that will help you to start moving forward outside of doing simple JavaScript and actually doing some exciting things. And what we're going to talk about is actually getting things from the API. So I'm going to quickly go over the code first, and then we're going to talk about some of the things that we use in this code. And again, if you're not sure what we're using, just go and Google it and look it up and do additional reading, which is something I recommend, and I'll probably reference that again later in this video. So here we are, we have this link here, and this is for the Chuck Norris jokes API. And here's the thing, when you're learning JavaScript or you're learning HTML and CSS, or you're aspiring to be a web developer, the truth is it's not enough to be able to make a front end page, because you don't want to be hard coding any data into that page. You want it to dynamically get that data from a database via an API. And what I'm saying here is that you don't have to make your API from scratch, especially when you're just starting out. You're able to find existing APIs, like in this case, we have Chuck Norris quote generator, and use those to practice how to make your fetch request, get the data, and work with it. Now, this is going to be a very beginner-friendly tutorial, and I hope you guys enjoy it, but this applies to more complex projects as well. And not in this video, but in my other videos, I'll talk about some ways how you could leverage this idea of maybe not creating a backend from scratch, but being able to create a backend using things like Strapi and Heroku with Postgres SQL database, and have a nice backend where you could easily manage your database without being a backend developer, and have a nice endpoints that you could hit when creating your front facing web apps, either with JavaScript and HTML and CSS or with React.js. So I think it's very valuable to start thinking about that when you learn HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. You have to understand that being able to work with data, being able to get that data via fetch or third-party libraries like Axios, is an important step. So enough talking, let's kind of get going. So what do you need first? Let's first go over this code, and then we'll talk more about it. All right, guys, so before going through the code, let's just go through the functionality again. So we have a button here. When you click the button, it fires an onclick event that calls a function that handles getting this message from an API. It also dynamically changes the name in the button to say show another. So you're like, okay, I want to see another one. And you click show another, and it shows the another Chuck Norris quote with show another. And notice every time you hit show another, the button text dynamically changes into loading to let you know that it's loading for the data. And once the data is loaded, it shows you the new information here. So not only are we able to get the data from the API, I just want to show you one more thing. We also using try and catch block in our function, and I'll kind of get more into that in a second. But the idea here is that we want to have some sort of error handling. So in this case, if something happens, if there's some sort of error, we don't want our app to crash, right? We want it to give us a nice user-friendly message that something happened. So if I come here and I mess up the URL that we definitely need to be able to get our jokes. So when I hit click joke, it says something went wrong and it shows the error that we have and kind of a little bit more information about it. And we could see, okay, this is probably wrong here. So normally you wouldn't show the error to the user. You just have a nice friendly message that says try again. But in this case, I just wanted to show it and have it some way to handle an error, because there's an error, no matter how many times you hit this button, it's not gonna fix the error. So you're like, okay, I'll come back another time when the developer fixed that issue. So we're gonna fix it here. And we also have, and I'm going to kind of do this right here for a second, we have our API make a request. I'll come back to this in a second. I just want to explain why we have another if and else statement here. So we are getting some sort of data from our API, and I'm going to go over it in a second, but that data has a type which says success. So basically what I'm saying here, I'm checking here, if the type with success comes back, okay, do something with it, show that data, because that means something is there. Whenever we don't get type equals to success, maybe there's an error, maybe there's some other message, I want to show no joke found, try again. So we're handling that case, why if our API doesn't return the correct data, instead of again having our app broken, we want to show them a nice message. So with that being said, here we are, I fixed the error. Let me reset here so we could see this function again. So if we say show joke, it's going to show, man, these Chuck Norris jokes are killing me. It's going to show more Chuck Norris quotes. So with that being said, let's see how it works. So we talked about a button, and we talked about there's an area here which shows the quote. So what I'm doing, I'm already creating those points or those elements in my HTML. So I have a normal div. You don't have to worry about the CSS. It's super basic. That basically contains a div, and this is using ID joke container, because this is where we're going to dynamically insert our HTML via JavaScript. And we also have this button, which uses button ID, because this is going to have an onClick event that when we click the button is going to fire some sort of action. So with these two things kept in mind, let's come back to our right side here. So we have three constants here. The first one is the Chuck Norris API, and we need this URL because this is what allows us to connect to the API. But for our functionality of our JavaScript app, we have our joke container. So we're using document get element by ID. This is not the only way to select elements in JavaScript. This is the best way or the easiest way to learn and teach when you're just starting out. So we're getting an element by ID with the idea of joke container. And basically what that's going to return, it's going to return this div in this joke container constant. So basically we have access to this, and we could do things like insert new text or perform other actions. We're also doing the same thing with the button. In the button's case, we actually, once we select the button, we add an event listener, which is a click event. So basically anytime someone clicks the button, is gonna fire the event. And when the button is clicked, it will call this function, get videos from API. This should be get Chuck Norris quote from API, whatever. I was actually working on, I was gonna make the same thing I'm doing right now, but with videos, but then I was like, that's even more work. So let's do something much simpler. So you get Chuck Norris quotes, which are more fun. And so that is going to call this get videos from API, which should be called get Chuck Norris quotes from API. But that's not the point. The point is that it calls this function. Now, this function, if you're familiar with async, await, or promises, and using .then to resolve those promises, this might look weird for you. Like, why am I writing async? Well, basically, async, you could say it's asynchronous JavaScript. So what happens when you make a call to an API, it's not instantaneously fulfilled. It might take 1 minute, it might take 5 seconds, it might be instantaneous, but you can't control for that. So what you have to do, you have to wait until that action is resolved before doing something with the data. And that's basically what async await functions do. And again, I say always Google things. Don't just trust your instructor. Do some additional reading. So as you guys get here, we have this function in our try and catch block. try and catch plaque. So basically, we want to try something, and like I showed you before, if there's some sort of error, we want to make sure that we show our error. And we're handling the error in a very simple way. We're targeting our joke container. We're typing inner HTML, which basically will insert inner HTML between those joke container tags. So what we're doing here, we're using our template strings, which allows us to insert any variable, which basically refers to this error variable that we get when our catch runs, and we're putting this error and inserting it inside these template strings. If you haven't worked with template strings, please Google, take a look. But basically what they allow you to do, they allow you to insert variables within your strings in your JavaScript code. And basically whenever we have an error, just like we did before, it will print out this message. But if things succeed, then the first thing it's going to do is going to set our button to loading. For instance, when I click Notice how every time that function runs, it says loading first. And basically everything works in order down line by line in this case. So the first thing it's going to do is going to say, okay, set button text to loading. Next, it's going to use our fetch method, which is included in your web browser. So you don't have to do anything particular. You just type what fetch and you put your URL that you want to connect and you wait for a response. Once that response comes back, it is saved in our request variable. And in this case, we have to use .json to turn it into a JSON object that we could work with, which is going to be saved in this result. So in this case, if I go console.log result, that's what we should see here in our browser, trusty browser window here. So let's go to console. I'm going to show joke. Okay, so it shows success. That's from this console log. But above that is we have our initial console log, and we get an object which basically has a couple of different things in it, but we're really concerned with the value and the joke because we only just want to show the joke to the user. So the way this works, once we get our result, we're checking first to see if result type is success. If it is, let's show the joke. So we're targeting the joke container dot inner HTML, and we're adding this template string, and we're inserting our joke from our API to show to the user. And we're also changing the button inner text to show another. Once this function completes, there's nothing else to do. So we will just wait for you guys to push the show another button one more time and show another button one more time. Now, that's basically it for our function that we're firing. And as we could see here, the way and the reason why it works is because we connected that function via our @EventListener for a click event. So anytime we click the button, it's going to run that get function, get videos from API function. It's going to go through this code and show us our information here. So I know maybe this may seem like it's a lot, and it is. So if you're getting stuck and you having a hard time to file this code, don't worry about it. It does take time. But what I would do is just Google thing in isolation. For instance, I'm not sure what the hell is a sync await function or whatever. So you could go here, go to your trusty Google and write async await using fetch. Look, they actually have a great example here because look, a lot of people literally search the same things. And I love developermozilla.org, so why not just go here? So here, once it opens up, it's going to show you the basics of sync await. It's going to explain to you with some examples of how it works and why it works. You could read more about it, and they'll show you some examples. This is showing a promise, how you handle it with using .then statement. But in our case, in our example, we use our async await function. And if you look here, it looks almost identical to the way we did it. And to handle an error, notice that they're doing it slightly different. They're adding the catch statement after the fact, which is perfectly fine. But like I said, whenever you get stuck, don't wait for the instructor to explain things for you. Be proactive. Go Google it and check it out yourself. So back to our code here. So basically, quick review. Again, I'm going to put a link to this CodePen available if you guys want to take a look at it, play around with it, break things. But to kind of sum things up here, the first thing that we did, we identified the elements that we need to be able to connect to our JavaScript. and we are connecting to them via the IDs. We put those elements into variables and using document.getElement by ID to connect. Once we have those elements, we use those elements in our code. So for the case of the button, we are adding an addEvent listener. So whenever you click, it's going to call our main function, getVideosFromAPI, which basically makes a call to the API using fetch and returns the data that we need. It first tries to do this code here. So if it is successful, the first thing it's going to do is going to set the button to loading. Then we're going to get our request, get our data back from the API using fetch. Then we set the result of that request and convert it to a JSON format so it's easier for us to work with. Here in the if statement, I am adding additional check just in case if the result type, which comes back in this request result object, is equal to success, go ahead, show our joke by using inner HTML to insert that HTML inside our code. And we're also using button.innerText to rename the text in the button to say show another. If it does not match success, we want to say no jokes found and change the text in the button, try again. So to show you this again via the example, let's open this again. I'm going to refresh this. The first thing that happens when we click show joke, it fires our addEvent listener and it fires that function that we talked about. If everything is looking good, it's going to display this text in this div here and it's going to change our button text to show another inside this button element. If we click it again, it's just going to keep showing our next quote. And again, if you don't have any errors, it's not going to have a problem. As soon as we introduce an error, let's say if I say maybe it's not equal to success and now we show another or show joke, it's going to say no joke found because it does not match the case that we want. And if something completely breaks and we click show joke, it's going to go through our try. It's going to try our code. Oh, it didn't work. Then it's going to default to that catch statement here, which is basically going to show, I guess I should spell something right, something went wrong, and it will insert the error. So as we could see, if we have issues, something went wrong is going to show the error. So let's go fix the error to bring everything back to normal. All right, guys. So I am going to put this in the description so you guys could check it out. If you wanted to see me typing the code out as I showed to you, let me know. I could also do that as well. But I think sometimes just being able to go over code and read the code and kind of understand at the beginning to get a bigger overview is also just as important. So what I would recommend to you guys is to go ahead, go look over the code and then see if you could recreate this by yourself and put your own spin on it. So with that being said, the last thing I'm going to show you is where to find the Chuck Norris API. You could literally type Chuck Norris API and it's going to take you somewhere. I type Chuck Morris, not interested because not as cool, and I'm amazed that it didn't auto-corrected me to Chuck Norris. So we go to Chuck Norris because it's the greatest man alive. And here you are, you have your API. So basically for this example, so I went here, I copied the request. You could learn more about how to use the API here, but this was the simplest way. And I basically left it at random, where basically every time you call this API, it is going to basically show you one random joke. So I hope you guys learned something today. It was a lot of fun doing these tutorials for you, going over code. Let me know if you guys like these style videos or if you want me to type stuff out. But I think it's important to be able to read the code. If you're not sure what it is, Google the stuff that you're not sure about and then try to recreate it. Because honestly, at my job, a lot of times I don't write code from scratch. I look at what other people wrote and then I have to implement some additional functionality, and that all starts by being able to understand the code that is already there. And I just want to say thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.